tonight, Fortis family. Thank you for joining our Fortis Primetime finale brought to you by Kingston College Old Boys Association International. We trust that you and your family are well and keeping safe. My name is Rainford Perry Bloomfield, Perry for short, and I will be your moderator tonight, along with Royland Gordon, who is managing the clicks, and Alton Brown and George Bell managing the Q&A. So allow me to give you a bit of housekeeping. You're on a webinar where you can only watch and or listen to tonight's presentation and interact with the presenters by posting questions for the Q&A segment towards the end. General questions will be answered throughout the evening, and we will follow up to any questions we did not get to in the Q&A. So be sure to leave your contact information and we'll get back to you. So, to set the stage, let's tune in to a newly recorded performance by our Kingston College Chapel Choir singing Psalm 150. Okay, your Kingston College Chapel Choir. And before we proceed, I just want you to introduce you, have you meet on screen at least our presenters for this Primetime finale. Gentlemen, you're all here with us tonight. Okay, so let's get into it. This time I invite the Reverend Canon Calvin McIntyre, OD, to lead us in the opening prayer.
We will pray for parents and teachers and all institutions of learning We will pray for those whose lives have been disrupted by the pandemic. Let us pray. O eternal God, bless all schools, colleges, and universities, and especially Kingston College, that they may be lively centers for learning, for new discovery, and the pursuit of wisdom. And grant that those who teach and those who learn may find you to be the source of all truth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Give ear to our prayers, O Lord God, and direct the way of your servants in safety under your protection, that amid all the changes of our earthly pilgrimage, we may be guarded by your mighty power. While we journey in the shadow of this pandemic, we remember before you those who have fallen ill and those who have died. Do for them that which only you can do. Grant to us the gift of your presence, that we may be comforted and find our hope and strength in you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Canon. So, ladies and gentlemen, the question is, how did we get here tonight? Back in March this year, the COVID-19 pandemic became very real to us. We had lost 6 members of the Fortis family to the virus. Others we knew were battling to stay alive. The world and our Fortis community were hit hard. The Old Boys Association had to cancel all pending traditional fundraisers. But in all of the uncertainties, we said, when the going gets tough, the tough gets going. So all the Fortis organizations connected under the KCOBA International banner to launch this Fortis COVID-19 virtual event series. On April 30th, we launched the virtual primetime event where we featured our COVID-19 survivors, Alton Brown and Everton Howell, Dr. Norman Smith, business analyst and author Glenn Lamon, and Kingston College leadership, Michael Vaccianna, chairman, and Dave Myrie, principal. One of the highlights coming out of that event was the $20,000 matching fund challenge issued to us live. You rose to the challenge and we were awarded the $20,000 match. Thank you. We are so very grateful to the challenger who has asked us to remain anonymous. Due to the positive response to the open and the heartfelt dialogue, we produce a second Fortis COVID-19 town hall on June 25, where we focus on welfare and sports. That night, we presented the leaders of the organizations that made up Kingston KCOBA International. We learned much about the state of KC sports from Derek Banks, football manager, Leiford Grant, track and field head coach, and Richard Smith, sports master. The guidance counselors, Mrs. Nadine Esco and Reverend Roger Shaw, shared the psychosocial state of our students and their resilience in the pursuit of excellence. Ms. Juliet Wilson, the academic vice principal, reminded us of the impressive 90% pass rate of students who took 5 or more subjects in 2019. And the challenges COVID-19 is presenting. Plus, we learned from 2 generations of Fortis men committed to the institution, Professor Rainford Wilkes and Dr. Rowan Wilkes. So, ladies and gentlemen, there are few constants that surfaces: the resilience of our students, the dedication of our leadership team and staff, and your commitment to the continued success of Kingston College. We are proud of the work that we've done so far in response to this pandemic and its ongoing economic challenges. There is still work to be done. This Fortis COVID-19 relief effort is critical to ensure that Kingston College not only survives, but also continue to thrive into the new normal. So, as promised, tonight's Fortis COVID-19 primetime event is the last of our three-part series focused on the new teaching and learning environment. The chairman of the board, Mr. Michael Vaccianna, and the principal, Mr. Dave Myrie, return tonight to give us an update on the state of the institution for the start of school. And they are joined by our esteemed Fortis brothers, Mr. Damion Crawford, lecturer at the University of the West Indies and community activist, and the legendary cricketer and cricket commentator, Mr. Michael Holding. We will close after responding to your questions in the Q&A section. I have a prayer from Father Michael Brown, the minister at Kingston College, and close with another performance from the Kingston College Chapel Choir newest production. So, with that said, let's get into tonight's presentation. And in true fashion, as we've been doing, we're gonna, before we reveal the chairman of the board, we're gonna stir things up a bit with our passionate cry for 95 years of excellence.
But committed no crime and bad mistakes.
I love Casey! This is my side!
I've had my shots and kicks in my face, but I've come through.
I need to go!
Ladies and gentlemen, joining us is our chairman of the board of Kingston College, Mr. Michael Vaccianna.
Good evening, everyone. Are you hearing me?
Yeah, we're loud and clear, sir.
Okay, great. Yes. Reverend gentlemen, Terry and his team, principal, fellow panelists, Michael Olin, and everyone gathered. Thank you all for joining. And I first want to say a few thank yous to some people. First of all, to Perry and his team and the other chapters, the old boy chapters, who have come up with this concept of this COVID event, online event. And it has been bringing results, positive results, as Perry has explained, and it certainly is a welcome change to the distress that many of us have been going through in this COVID environment. I also want to say thanks to those who have made financial contributions. I think in the April 30 event, we had painted a sort of dismal picture, certain financial challenges that we face. And I see that a number of you have come up to the line and have made contributions, and we welcome and appreciate the help that has come forward. So as I also want to update you on what the what I've been doing, some of the things I've been doing in the school. The principal will give you a lot of details, but I will sort of give you an overview of what has been happening. It has been extremely challenging times and in a number of areas. But I want to highlight the work that the principal and his staff have done. They have gone beyond the call of duty. They have worked with students in revision for CSEC and CAPE. They have supervised those exams, and they have run a summer school, and have been very involved in the preparation for reopening of school. And I want to say a special thanks to them. But I want to share with you something that I don't think Mr. Myrie will freely share with you. And it is this: the Ministry of Education made a request to all schools to provide a plan for the resumption of on-campus learning within a COVID environment. Principal and his senior staff prepared a plan, brought it to the board, and the plan was approved. Our information is that when the principal submitted this plan to the ministry, they were so impressed that they asked if they could use Kingston College's plan as a model for all other schools. And that is the caliber of the administrators we have in Kingston College. And I really want to big them up and say that how eternally grateful we are to the work that they've been doing. Our emphasis, really, the board that is, have been to ensure that the environment that is set up and provided when students return to school is one that will keep them in safety and that will protect them from harm that the COVID environment can bring. So we have been looking at a number of areas. It includes health and hygiene requirements. We have done some work on improving our information technology to better undertake online classes. In this regard, we have to do network upgrade, not only for online classes in the COVID environment, but also to provide capacity for the new technology center that is being built as we speak, and hopefully will be in active use by the end of this year. The infrastructure changes in the school are also significant because we have to make space to allow for social distancing between our students and other staff. And just to provide an environment where the curriculum can be delivered in a safe environment. As a result, additional staff is needed, and we have hired some already. The welfare needs of students, we anticipate, will be heightened because many of you might know that already, even before COVID, we've had to assist students with welfare. And we expect that with the challenges that have come with COVID, especially the economic challenges for parents and so on, those needs are going to be greater going forward. We have assisted some students with tablets with the help of some old boys. And we have also had to provide additional security in the school, which will be needed, especially when school reopens, to assist primarily with compliance with the various protocols that we have established and will implement. All of this comes with a cost. And as I did on the last occasion, I have to go there and speak to you a little about cost. So far, we have spent over $5 million additional to deal with these preparations for addressing the COVID requirements, the protocols, and so on. There is more that we're going to have to spend. And these funds are coming from just the regular funds that we collect for the regular running of the for the normal running of the school. We haven't gotten any additional funds as yet from the ministry or elsewhere to assist with that. Thankfully, we are getting assistance from from various chapters of the Old Boys, and that has been really a welcome development. And I want to say thanks again to the various Old Boys chapters that have come forward to make contributions. In doing this, I want to share with you the sort of operating costs that we are facing. The school has a budget, annual budget, of $120 million, roughly. The Ministry of Education provides, again, for tuition, roughly $33 million. Parental contribution is budgeted at $40 million. We don't expect to collect $40 million from parents. We haven't done so for the past few years, and we expect that that is even going to be worse in the COVID environment, where a lot of families are experiencing economic hardship. So we don't expect the $40 million. Even with that, we'd have had a shortfall of $47 million that normally would come from contributions from Old Boys and other benefactors, from fundraising events, and just donations generally. The shortfall is going to be more than $47. So we are looking at a future where we are either going to have to redouble our efforts of collecting from contributors, from well-wishers, from Old Boys, and from fundraising events. Or we're just going to have to cut back on some of our offerings to our students, which is really the last resort that we're facing. So with this sort of situation facing us, I don't want to leave you just with a dismal picture, but it is a reality that we face. And it is a reality that has to be shared with people who are interested in Kingston College. It has to be shared with the Kingston College family generally, because we're going to need help. There's still a lot of uncertainty as to when school will open. The date has been pushed back now. And there's probably still some uncertainty about that date, but students have been taught, and if they're not in class, we're going to have to be doing online teaching. So we are making the best effort, putting the best foot forward to ensure that we can maintain, to a certain degree, the sort of standards that we have at Kingston College in terms of learning and teaching. And we can only succeed if we have support and help from persons like you online with us tonight, and certainly from other interested parties within the Kingston College family. We are hopeful, and we are going forward with a sense of purpose and with optimism, because we know that the brave may fall but never yield, and we will get through this, and we will get through this together. So thank you very much for listening, and hope that this evening will be an enlightening one for all of us gathered. Thank you.
The chairman, thank you so very much for that presentation on the business of Kingston College. And we thank you for your leadership, sir. So it's time to pivot to Principal Myrie. I'm sure we're eager to learn the details as presented from that overview. So without any delay, let's welcome our principal of Kingston College, Mr. Dave Myrie.
Thank you. Thank you, Perry. Thank you, Perry. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Go ahead, principal. Go ahead.
Fine. Thank you, Perry, and good night. To fellow presenters, to moderators, and also to our Fortis family and friends of Fortis who are out there listening. I'm going to take you a bit through a fair bit of information about the school, updating as to what's going on, where we're at, and you know, give you some details as well. So I'm going to ask you to bear with me. All right. As you know, and I'll give you a little bit of the history here. As you know, schools were mandated to close on March 13th, and the school transitioned immediately to an online platform. Now, it took us roughly 3 to 4 days to move from face-to-face to full online teaching. And obviously, there are teething problems, but we persevered and worked those out. During the month of April, we focused on improving the online experience for our students, and there are a number of problems that we came across. One, we had students who had no device, so they couldn't log on. We had students who had a device but no data, so they couldn't log on either. We had students who there's a device in the home, but there are two or three school-age kids in the home, and they have to share that device. So there are days that they would not be able to log on because it's not their day to use the device. It's the day for their sibling. You also had situations where students had absolutely no internet in the area. And we moved as best as possible to solve these problems. But no device, we started a drive to get tablets and to give to those students who were able to do that too. And we did that for a number of students. Whether we bought tablets, begged tablets, and we got some tablets into those students' hand. For the students who had a device, no data, we had both teachers and old boys who would send credit to that youngster so that youngster would be able to log on and be part of that class as well. The device, only one device in the home, we go back to the tablets and try to add another device in the home for those parents, so we allow those kids to be able to log on. For the kids where no internet was available, we did a fair amount of printed material and sought to get that printed material into the hands of those kids. And so we did the best we could to solve a number of those problems, and we were able to alleviate some. To further manage our online program as well, we decided that every single senior manager in the school needed to get involved. And so each of us as senior managers, including myself as principal, took responsibility for a particular year group. I was responsible for sixth form, and we managed all the affairs of that year group, which made it easier working with the teachers, working with the parents, working with our parent reps, all trying to ensure that those year groups functioned efficiently, and that worked well for us. So throughout the latter part of April into May, we saw an increase in the number of students logging on and attending classes, which we're quite pleased with, because ultimately we wanted to ensure that if not all our kids logged on. I'd say we had roughly maybe 85% consistently logging on, and then you may have maybe up to 90% coming on and off, if you like. So towards the end of May, however, we were advised by the Ministry of Education that all examination students would return to school for 4 weeks of face-to-face revision classes. And those revision classes began on June 5th. Just hearing that brought a whole new set of priorities for us. Because even though we'd been going into school monitoring the online program, now we had a situation where we had to move into face-to-face. So we're going to the blended approach. So it moved away from just online now to a blended approach of face-to-face as well as online, because the online program had to continue for first to fourth, and face-to-face took place for fifth and sixth. And we're looking at approximately 600 students there. However, before we could even contemplate having students back in the physical environment, we had a lot of changes and preparation to make. And I'll just highlight some of these, not in order of priority, but just highlighting some of the changes. One of the first things we had to do, taking into consideration the COVID-19 social distancing policy, is get out our tape measure, rulers, and go and measure up every single classroom to ensure that we're adhering to the 6 feet social distancing. So vice principals, deans, myself, we're all out there, guidance counselor, we're all out there measuring up classrooms to ensure that we're maintaining that 6 feet social distancing. And in essence, our classrooms each could hold roughly about between 15, sometimes to 20 students. And so the entire campus was being used. We had to redesign classes, again, to ensure that they could comfortably accommodate these students as they come in. We had to install additional hand washing stations. We have installed 3 additional hand washing stations, installing soap dispensers. We installed several contactless sanitizing dispensers around the school. We had to develop isolation areas for kids who may come in and have elevated temperatures. We had to have an isolation area. We had to secure temperature devices or temperature guns, and we acquired a number of those thanks to the Florida KCOBA, who sent us roughly about 12 or more of these guns. We had to increase the water storage capacity, because we had a situation whereby there's sometimes water from the National Water Commission may be limited in terms of there may be lockoffs, and once there was no water in the school, that means we had to close the school, because considering the whole issue of COVID-19, and the impact of that, you had to have water so kids could be regularly washing their hands, doing what needed to be done. So we had to increase the water storage capacity. We had to deep clean the entire school, which costed us a pretty penny. We had to stock up on alcohol and hand sanitizers. We had to develop special timetable for the revision period, because as we said, we had 600 kids coming in. We couldn't have every kid in at the same time, so we had to set up a program that had staggered time frame for the kids to come in, but to ensure they all got the amount of time they needed to have in school with face-to-face with their teachers. We had to identify staff shortage and fill those voids, because obviously we had a number of staff who had underlying comorbidities, so they couldn't come into the environment, so we had to find other teachers. And I pause here to mention this as well. Even though we had our upper school teachers, as in fourth to sixth form teachers, a number, nearly all of our junior school teachers, at Melbourne teachers, turned in to come and support. Even though they weren't teaching upper school, they turned out to come and support what was going on. And that was, you know, just so good to see that even though they know we weren't teaching these classes, we're not the teachers for these classes, they all turned out to help, because we needed every classroom manned. And so we're quite pleased on that. We even had past head boy who came back and was there every day helping to man classes and ensure that the revision program went on. So we're very, very pleased with that. We had to provide personal protective equipment for all members of staff. And so we provided masks, face shield, gloves, hand sanitizers, because we had to ensure that they were safe in the environment as well. We had to secure increase in personnel. So additional security was put in place to ensure that there was enough personnel to manage the inflows of students daily. And the security personnel were responsible for checking the temperatures under the guidance of the nurses who helped us, and also recording the name and phone number, as well as temperature reading for everyone who came into the school environment. It doesn't matter whether they're just coming to the office or it didn't matter. They had to have all of that done. And this was important, particularly if we had to do contact tracing. It was quite important. We also deployed security personnel across all areas or entrances to the campus to make sure we're properly covered in all areas, and everywhere persons went, they were properly checked before they could enter. In fact, I digress, just mentioned this, you know, on the first morning of revision, obviously, as you know, we're at Kingston College, we had a number of reporters who turned up from the Gleaner, from Observer, from wherever, just to see what was going on at Kingston College. They could have gone to other schools, but obviously no, Kingston College had to be it. So they turned up, and there's one who he got checked going through the main gate at the pedestrian gate for the school. Then she came, she wanted to come and see me. She got checked again and hand sprayed, tried to enter the admin building. And just for the icing on the cake, I also checked her temperature when she came into my office as well. And she was saying she's never been checked that many times in her life just to get into an environment. But we're ensuring that the persons in the environment are safe, and so we have to do what we need to do. We had to install COVID-19 safety protocol posters in all classrooms and around the school, and we had to secure the help of nurses. Now, this one to me is a pretty big one, because we have 2 campuses, normally we'd have 2 nurses. However, we're down to 1 nurse at that point, another nurse we had migrated. And the 1 nurse we had, about 2 weeks before the start of the revision program, she resigned as she was called away to work further elsewhere in the National Health Service. In discussion with our PTA president, She then sent around to find out how many nurses we have in the school, who could assist in terms of nurses as parents in the school, and who could assist. And it was just amazing. A number of parents responded who are nurses, and it worked out that we had roughly four or five nurses nearly every day. We had nurse cover right through the whole revision period. Nurses came out. They were there to monitor temperature checks, monitor what's going on, also help to ensure that all the different things that we need to do to adhere to the Ministry of Health Safety Protocol were in place. And so, you know, I really want to highlight these parents or nurses who came out and supported us in that period, which was just invaluable and absolutely amazing. And when I talk about selfless, they came. There's one nurse in particular, Nurse Antoinette, who kind of led the charge, and she was there all the time. It's just absolutely amazing the work that they did for us, and I want to actually recognize that in a big way. All of what I've just indicated that was done on North Street, a similar operation had to be done at the Melbourne Park campus as well, the Juna campus. We had several visits from the Minister of Health as well as the Ministry of Education. We're wondering why they were visiting KC so frequently, but anyhow, we had loads of visits from them. The Ministry of Health, you know, it was interesting that, you know, one group would come and say, okay, your isolation area is fine, everything's okay. Another group comes back and said, no, you need to add this, you need to add that to the isolation area. But notwithstanding, we did what we needed to do, and in the main, they were pretty pleased with what we did. And what the four weeks period of revision did was to actually allow us to test our COVID-19 reopening plan. And to recognize that a number of elements in the plan were great, worked well, and to also allow us to tweak areas that we may need, that needed tweaking, just to make sure that we are doing quite well in the environment. The revision period, I would say, went very well. And examinations, CXC and CAPE exams started in mid-July. At the point the school was closed in March, we were in the middle of mock exams. So to all intent and purposes, the syllabus for each subject would have been between 90% to 95% completed. So the online classes and the revision program helped to address gaps that existed for our students and got them pretty ready for exam, because a lot of the time that we spent in the revision program was spent on examination preparation and practice, getting ready for the exams. Based on the feedback, exams started on, as I said, mid-July, and based on the feedback from the boys, they think they did very well. It always bothers me and worries me when they come and say, oh, we've done extremely well, because I said to myself, well, that means you failed. I like to hear them come and say, boy, sir, you know, the exam was a little bit hard, but I think, you know, I tried and did as best as I could. Anyhow, the results will be out at the end of September. And so we wait on the results to see how well our boys did. But based on what we did, the performance of our boys last year, with over 90% of our boys achieving five or more CXCs, I'm expecting us to do pretty well with this examination period going forward. We had set targets that were impacted by COVID, obviously, but we're still looking forward to our boys doing pretty well, you know, when the exam results come out. And so the whole push on the academic front, from the time we closed and went online to the exams taking place, even though we had a number of teething problems, as I said, that there are difficulties and challenges, but as the chairman had said, you know, the brave may fall but never yield, and we're always going to find solutions to the problems to ensure that we continue to deliver to our youngsters and deliver for our youngsters in the way that we need to. I want to just add here as well that, in spite of the delay in examination results and no boys and girls champs, based on their current standing and their academic standing, we're still able to secure full scholarships for over 22 of our boys, and virtually all of them have already left, and they're in the States now attending college around. So, and that is the highest, as far as I'm aware, the highest number of boys to achieve full scholarships in the school ever. And so we're just very, very pleased that that took place and our boys were able to move on. Now, everything seems to just happen all together, because while exams were going on and we're busy trying to make sure that everything functioned well, we had our new intake sent to us from the ministry, the list of new intake from the primary exit profile, the PEP list that was sent to us to manage. And we're looking at roughly maybe about 300 students that converge, well, parents converging on us at different points, having knowing that they've passed. But even more so was the 300 plus persons who converged on the school seeking transfers. And that's a big issue and quite a bit of a headache to manage, because everyone from every woodwork and crevice, you know, come out, oh, we need a transfer. Can you help? You know, the persons who are contacting me, I hadn't spoken to them in 10 years. And they, however, they got a hold of me and, oh, Mr. Myrie or Dave, you remember me? And I'm saying, yeah, vaguely, you know, we're seeking a transfer. So we had that going on while we're still trying to manage exams. But again, as always, we actually did what we needed to do and got through that. We were able also to hold a summer school that kind of coincided with the exam period as well. And the summer school, which was really part of a kind of orientation for our new students, particularly our PEP students, that went well. Again, all safety protocols outlined in our COVID-19 reopening plan were put in place. And, you know, we really made sure we adhere to that in a big way. And, you know, happy to say, the summer school went off without incident at all. Examinations went off without incident. The revision program went off without incident. And we're just quite pleased with how things went. Having said that, going forward, what are we going to be doing? Well, initially, we're preparing for school to start in early September. However, due to the significant increase in COVID-19 cases in Jamaica at the moment, that we move from having, you know, 10 or 12 per day, that we're looking at 100 and odd, those kind of figures. I think today it must have been 70 odd or 80 odd new cases. And based on that, the government indicated that the reopening of school will be pushed back to the 5th of October. All right. Now, clearly that gives us a little bit of time, but whether or not it was going to be the 7th of September, we would have been ready to go, because since the 5th of June that we've been out, all of us as senior managers in the main have been out back in school, making sure we get things ready, timetable ready, hiring staff that we need to hire, making sure we have enough furniture in place, making sure all the classrooms were structured in a way to adhere to social distancing on both campuses, meeting with security personnel as we have to increase the number of security personnel across both campuses, making sure everything is in place for an early start, stocking up again on all the hand sanitizers, masks, etc. that we needed to have to ensure that we could go. Now, so school will start in October, on October 5th as we speak. That's what we know. Not sure what will happen if things continue the way they are. We could have a pushback, but we wait for the Ministry of Education to advise us for that. Yeah. We had intended to have an orientation, at least for first formers, and some level of face-to-face orientation. And the way we're going to do that, would have done that by class group. We're roughly talking about 40, 42 boys per class. Our chapel can hold at least about 400 persons. With social distancing, we may have about 200 persons in there, and would have done class group by class group, because we felt that, at least for our first formers, there need to be some level of, you know, face-to-face with parents, but it was going to be done in a way that ensured that social distancing was fully adhered to, two persons per bench in the chapel, that sort of thing, and would have met with them. Now, the determination in terms of how we function come whenever school open is that we're going to be doing a blended approach to the teaching and learning process. What we mean by that is that we would have some level of face-to-face, but we'll also be doing a fair degree of online. And just to give you a sense of what would happen, let's take first to third form. Each of those classes, we're roughly looking at about 40 to 43 or 44 students. Those classrooms can, with social distancing, hold roughly about 22 students. So each class group, each class would be split in two. So you'd have group one, group two. So just take one first form group then. Say Seven Harding. Hardy split into two, group one, group two. Group one week one when school starts. Group one would attend school Monday, Wednesday, Friday. Group two would attend school Tuesday, Thursday. Week two, group two would attend school Monday, Wednesday, Friday. Group one would now come Tuesday, Thursday. But it doesn't stop there, because all classes, no matter what, will be Zoomed. And we spend time, and I'll speak to that a little further in terms of financing, to make sure we secured or procured web cameras and tripods to cover every single classroom. And so every class will be Zoomed. So on the day that a child's not in school, that child can log in and be part of their class group in terms of what is being taught there. All of those lessons are going to be recorded and uploaded as well, so students can go back to look at them, listen to them, follow through as well. So, and we've also made provision for those kids who may not have devices, and I'll speak to that a little later. We also have made provision for those kids who may not have any data, and I'll speak to that a bit later as well. And we've made provision for those kids who may have no internet connection whatsoever, and those kids, we're seeking to have those kids in school on as many days as possible. We already have a situation where their parents have written to us to indicate that when school opened, based on what's going on, they won't be sending their child physically in, and so that child will be taking full advantage of the online program that we'll be offering, and so that's fine. And so where kids have no internet access, those kids, we're going to try and make sure those kids get into school as frequently as possible, and also we're providing quite a lot of written and printed material for those schools as well. We're seeking to keep our fifth form in school every day based on the fact that they have CXCs just around the corner. And the reason we're able to do that is that outside of their form group, where they come together as a form for registration and that sort of thing, most we run what we call a pool system, and the pool roughly would have somewhere from about 20 to 25 students per pool, and we may be able to comfortably hold those kids in classrooms with social distancing in mind, and for our fifth formers. And so having that being the case, we try and maintain as much as possible to have our fifth formers in school every day. There may be one or two subjects though where the numbers are higher, and in that case we're going to have to again split those classes and have some attend on one day, and we're Zooming, so those who are not in will just log in via the internet as well. All right. We're also looking at lunchtime. We're going to have to manage that as well, because based on what's happening here, we can't have everybody bundling up in the canteen. And so in most cases, kids are going to have to eat in their classrooms, even though we have staggered lunch times. But most cases, they're going to have to eat in their classroom. And what we'll be doing is an order will be taken for every kid in the morning prior to doing registration. And that order would be delivered to the canteen. Those lunches would be prepared, packaged. We'd collect them, take them back to the class at lunchtime, hand them out. Kids eat in their class. And we're in discussion with the ministry right now for some, we call non-teaching assistants, who will be part of monitoring or assisting in those classrooms during lunchtime to ensure that kids, one, socially staying in the areas that they should, they're not congregating, but also that following that, they can actually move in an orderly way to go and get their hands washed and clean up before the next class as well. We're also looking at a bit of a staggered finish to each school day. So maybe a 10-minute staggered finish. So say first form finishes, then, after they get 10 minutes to move off the campus, be picked up, then next 10 minutes, second form, another 10 minutes, third form. And so we're working on that as well to see how best we can manage that, just to reduce the congestion on the campus. And if you know Melbourne Park campus very well, you realize there's not a lot of space there, not even for parking. And so we're going to have to manage that as best as possible to ensure that we're not having kids or parents congregating, but things are being moved through in a very efficient manner, so that we're always constantly adhering to the protocols and guidelines. And, the Ministry of Education, as well as Ministry of Health, they will turn up unannounced just to see what's going on and just to make sure that we're doing what we say we're doing. And so we want to ensure that we're always a step ahead and doing what needs to be done within the environment. Now, in order to do a lot of this, Zooming, pulls heavily on the whole issue of technology. And so there's a lot of work that we're doing there. Chairman mentioned some of that, but I'll give you a bit more. Just for information, and you know, Perry knows most of this because as far as technology is concerned, Perry and I have discussions virtually, I'd say every week, we're talking about technology and what we need to do. And he's one of my go-to persons as far as the whole issue of technology for KCs is concerned. We had to increase the bandwidth in the schools so we can facilitate Zoom classes. Now, just imagine that up until COVID, we had across the entire school, that's lower school and upper school, we were running on something like about 30 megabits across both campuses, 30 megabits. Now, if we had tried to Zoom classes, as I'm talking about with that, I don't even know if five of them would get on. We'd be knocking off people. There'd be downtime all the time. So we had to have discussions with one of our telecoms provider and thought to increase the bandwidth from 30 to 100 megabits in order that we can actually Zoom efficiently. And what we've done is we've done assimilation exercises already of putting 40, 50 cameras on both campuses to see whether or not we're going to be thrown off, how that's going to be functioning, because we're looking to see whether or not we need to increase our bandwidth beyond 100 megabits to whether 200 or otherwise. So far, it seems that things are working okay. We're going to see when we're in full swing, and we have the facility with the telecoms provider to make the increase as soon as that we recognize any problems exist. And there's a cost to that, which I'll speak to later on as well. We have to update the IT infrastructure and network, including cameras across the network, across the whole school. And one of our old boys, Dean Nevers, who owns a company, telecoms company, Conix, is assisting us in that endeavor. And, you know, as always, as an old boy, he does a heck of a lot for the school, for which we're grateful and continues to do so. And he's ensuring that, you know, we get a state-of-the-art upgrade to our network system so that we can effectively deliver our online program. And also, when all the labs come on stream, we're good, and even more so, that CXC is moving to a total, if you like, online examinations, that we're also set up nicely to deal with that as well. Interestingly, even basic things as looking at the whole electricity across the both campuses to ensure that every single classroom has functional electricity outlets in there, because obviously if you don't have an outlet, how are you going to plug in a laptop or plug in cameras or anything like that? So we're actually doing that upgrade to make sure that every single classroom has the facility where the electricity is fine, working efficiently. And also the other thing is that if you think that a lot of what we have, when the school started, we didn't have all the technology that's there now. So we have to also look at increasing, making sure the appropriate voltage is coming in. So when all this equipment goes on, we don't have risks of fire or anything like that. Again, all of that comes at a cost, which we're ensuring that is done. We're also securing tablets for our students. And I must mention here, you know, our newly formed KCOBA Europe in Europe. And, you know, I was on a Zoom meeting with them a couple weeks ago. And, you know, they're forming this association. And I spoke about the need for tablets, that, you know, the kids need tablets and we're trying to do what we can. They asked how many do I need right away. I said at least I need to start off with at least 30 tablets. And you know, I tell you, you know, I just shook my head when it happened. You know, one of the old boys, Sam's, who's very involved in that, in the formation of that KCOBA Europe, came into Jamaica and provided 34 tablets that we now can be able to use to hand out to students. And so I want to thank them for that. We're really appreciative of that. As we speak, however, one of our teachers who's tasked with handling a lot of the online stuff and technology, Miss Hope, we have questionnaires out with all our students just to identify all the technology needs even just, you know, what network do you use, etc., so we can have a good understanding of what's going on for each of our students. And we're particularly keen to get at that, you know, either 20, 15 or 20% that had issues logging on when we're doing the revision, when we're doing the online school, to make sure they're up and running as well. As I said, we secured web cameras and tripods for all of our classrooms, and, you know, just want to thank the KCOBA Florida, and particularly Wayne Hewitt, who assisted in providing the funding for that. We spent roughly about $2.2 million to secure those, and we're pleased to say we have the equipment. They're at school. In fact, they're hidden in my office at the moment. Make sure I can see them every day and know that they're there for us to use, and that the IT people are making sure we're all ready to go whenever the ministry says as well. We secured a number of laptops for staff. You know, we bought a few during the online program that there are staff who didn't have devices, and so we had to help out by buying a couple, giving to staff, and ensuring that they could effectively teach their classes online. But I want to also mention here the KCOBA Toronto, and particularly Alexander Francis, who secured a number of laptops for us and sent down a number of laptops that we're able to give to staff laptops. And now we're also able to actually outfit different rooms that we have to ensure that everyone can be online and do what needs to be done. So I want to thank them all for that, as we ensure that, you know, we're ready as far as technology is concerned to deliver to our students and ensure that none of our students lose out. Now, I'm going to move quickly to the welfare front for a second. And Chairman mentioned this, and I'm going to just elaborate a bit more on this. As you're aware, during the COVID lockdown, we students and the community, we did that. And even prior to that, we've been supporting a number of our students by providing them with packages on an ongoing basis to ensure that, you know, something was there for the family. We also had to be doing that for a number of parents who lost their jobs as well as a result of this COVID-19 pandemic, to help them, you know, with care packages, because other than that, they were going to have difficulties taking care of their kids and taking care of their families as well. We also, so we continued doing distribution to a number of kids who we know were having difficulties. We did that in a discreet manner, and, you know, they're very grateful for the help and for the support that we're providing there. During that time as well, even we did some welfare packages for teachers on Teachers Day. And again, I want to, you know, highlight the KCOBA Florida, the Atlanta Group, the Tampa Group, and also Sing Ching, Old Boy, the Progressive Supermarket Group here in Jamaica, who provided assistance in doing this for our kids. And we're very, very, and for our teachers as well, and we're very pleased about that. What we've recognized is that there will be a significant increase in welfare needs and demands as we go into a new school year. And it's about how we're geared and how we're set up to address that. We're seeing that already. I'll tell you a little story about something that happened while the parents were coming in during the new parents, that's the PEP parents, they were coming in to collect the packages. As near to, around by the bookshop one day, just watching the process, and a parent came, you know, spoke to the Miss Cummins in the bookshop, then left, looked a bit distraught. Anyhow, Miss Cummins came to me later on and said, you know, the parent came to her, she was coming to collect the packages, she didn't have enough funds to pay for the package, but she said she was told that if she came and she spoke to Mr. Myrie, he will find a way to get some money to her so that she can actually pay for the package, and that she'll receive what she needs to. I shook my head. I thought, imagine, we have parents who haven't even, and they're not even started the school as yet, and they already know that Casey will do whatever we can do for the welfare of our students. We're going to have a lot more cases as we go forward. We're already seeing that. They're already in, and a number of them have already been to the guidance councils to talk to them about the situation. And so I expect that, you know, and even coming out of this whole trauma of COVID-19, we're going to have a number of issues that we're going to have to address. You know, again, it might be emotional, psychosocial, and also I think they're going to be just straightforward welfare needs that we're going to have to be looking at. I expect we're going to have to be doing significant counseling as well, as people try to manage this. And look, we're counseling both the students and the parents, because the parents are also calling in for counseling and help. And so our guidance carried with a number of these parents, and I'm sure we're going to be even stretched more. One of the major concerns that I have is the whole issue of social distancing for students, because no matter how much you preach, once they're in the classroom, it's fine. But once they're outside the classroom in an unstructured way, then, you know, they're in their groups. Some of them want to take off the mask, and you have to be preaching. We flood the place with posters. And that's one of my concerns, because, the youngsters seem to feel that nothing at all can happen to them. And so that's one of my concerns, the whole issue of social distancing outside of the classroom. And we're going to have to be so vigilant on that in order for us to, maintain the kind of standards that we need to in the school. But that's a big concern, and that's why we're focusing very heavily on the lunchtime situation as well, because the lunchtime situation is one of those situations that, if not properly managed, the social distancing thing can become a little bit of an issue. So we're looking at all of these, and we're putting things in place, particularly for lunchtime. But then again, the other issue that I always grapple with is that we ask them, and they're doing the social distancing when they come into school. But when they jump on the bus or the taxi, which are inches away from other persons, the social distancing is not necessarily in place. And sometimes, you know, as I drive along the road, I will just look in buses and see what percentage of persons are actually wearing masks and what percentage is not. And you're going to find people who are wearing their masks, but you're also going to find people who are not. And, you know, that bothers me a bit. But we're going to have to do whatever we need to do as best as possible to protect our school environment. And as I said, you know, everyone who comes into the environment, we always will be temperature checked. We'll do random checking during the day as well, sanitize. And, you know, we're making sure that as much as we're able to, we're following all the guidelines. No, not as much as we're able to. We are following all the guidelines that are set up by the Ministry of Health and Ministry of Education. And, you know, just to impress on our kids that, look, at the end of the day, we need you to be safe. And even more so, we need your parents to be safe. And so we're going to ask you to just make sure you adhere to all the guidelines that we're saying. So we're going to have to preach it daily, minute by minute, just to ensure that we get the message through. I'm going to shift a bit now to the whole issue of financing. And the chairman spoke to that for a bit, and I'll just raise, as the chairman had said, the operating budget, and this is just the operating budget or the maintenance budget. I'm not talking about paying teachers. That's a different thing. That's dealt with by the Ministry of Education. But the budget for the school that pays the electricity, pay the bills and all of those things, we're looking at roughly, we're looking at $120 million. Yeah. Of that, the ministry provides $33 million, because basically they provide $17,000 per student, and that is calculated about 1,941 students at $17,000, roughly about $33 million. Chairman spoke to parental contribution, and basically what we're asking parent as a contribution is $26,000. $2,500 of that goes to the PTA, and the rest to the school. So roughly the actual school contribution is 22,000. Now, even though we have 1,900 and odd parents, we calculate that if 1,500 parents pay that 26,500, we roughly should get to that 40 million. But again, even just watching what is happening now, the contribution that parents are giving are very low, woefully inadequate. So I don't see us getting to that 40 million. But even if we did get to that 40 million, we'd still have a shortfall of 47 million to make up. And that's a big one. So I guess you could add that from the 47 million, or the 40 million that parents should pay, we might as well take it now that you may only get 20 million of that. So we're going to have a 6 or 7 million deficit to make up in terms of going forward. Yeah. That's a big deficit to make up within a school environment. And we're still expected to deliver quality programs, quality education, but an old principal I know years ago called Pam Harrison said to me, it takes cash to care. And when you say that, people say, oh, you're focused on money. But at the end of the day, without funds, you can't deliver what you want to at the level you want to. And let's be clear about that. They say nothing in life is really free at the end of the day. All right. I just want to add some other things that Chairman mentioned and highlight them as well. In preparation for just getting kids back to school, for the revision program, we spent over 5 million with deep cleaning, hand sanitizers, putting in additional hand washing stations, or chemicals, all sorts of things. We spent over 5 million on that. We have to increase security personnel because in the main, the security personnel are the ones who monitor all the gates, do the temperature checks, record what happened, record the temperature, take down contact details, and that we're seeing an increase in that of roughly about 4 million. The web cameras and tripods, as I mentioned before, we looked at roughly about 2.2 million for those. The increase in the bandwidth for the internet connectivity for a Zoom class, which I had to do, is running us roughly about 500,000 per month. So we're looking at roughly about 6 million per year for that. And the upgrade in the network and access points that we need to do in the camera system that we're doing, which is more than just the COVID, but also for when we go full online for exams, all of that sort of thing, we're looking at roughly about $8 million. These are all in Jamaican dollars, I'd say, for those. We're looking at additional ancillary cleaners, ancillary workers, both cleaners and groundsmen, roughly about the 2.7 million there. And then furniture and all of what our needs there, we're looking at about another 3 million. And so in essence, yeah, just to quickly mention them again, the preparing for the revision classes and back to school because of COVID, roughly about 5 million there. Increased security personnel, we talked about 4 million for the year. Web cameras, which we did about 2 million. The increase in bandwidth, as I said, moving from the 30 megabits to the 100 megabits, is seen as paying roughly 500,000 Jamaican dollars per month. So we're looking at about 6 million per year. Upgrading the network and the camera system at school, roughly about another 8 million. And the additional workers that we need, roughly about 2.7 million. And furniture repairs, about 3.6 million. I must say to you very importantly and clearly, all of what I've just indicated is over and above the operating budget of the school, the 120 million I mentioned before. These are additional things to that 120 million. I want to also add, because, you know, there's some KCO boys, also friends of KC, who will say, oh, we can't raise any money because we don't know what the budget is. Everybody knows that Casey needs money no matter what, yeah? And so I always find that spurious. But anyhow, here are more numbers. There are a number of programs in the school that we do. And those programs are what go to form or make out the roundedness of the offering that we do at KC and develop rounded students as well. It's those offerings that allow for so many of our kids to be able to get scholarships and go overseas. So let's give you some numbers for some of those. The football program that we run in KC is roughly a 15 million per year program. The track and field program, roughly 25 million per year. The hockey program, 2 million. The rugby program, 2.5 million. Table tennis, 1.6 million. Basketball, roughly about 5 million. Lacrosse, roughly about 2.5 million. And school challenge quiz, which we love so dearly and always want to win, roughly about $1.8 to $2 million. And so those are numbers, real numbers, in terms of what the school has to do. How are those numbers normally made up? Yeah, outside of those things we're now having to do, both for the increase in bandwidth and for our upgraded network. Most of these activities, particularly the sporting activities, how do we actually cover that? Generally speaking, donations from friends of Kingston College, the old boys chapters, that's how we normally make up those shortfalls. you know, begging, and also, you know, persons who will say, yes, I want to support football, and they put their funds there. You know, in that way, you know, I always have to highlight the management team for the football program, you know, Banks, Donovan, Jermaine, Bunny, Dean, Nevers, Darren, you know, Yaki, all of these guys who push hard to make sure that program's funded properly and that it's not a burden on the school, to be honest with you. And so we really want to thank them for that as well. So folks, there's some real numbers as far as what we have to do. So when you see, you know, my head this bald, you can understand, because I have to pull out every little hair or every strand that's there just to ensure, because when the pressure comes, you know, I suppose that's what I have to do for the stress relief, because running the school and making sure things function, it really is difficult. And the board is there, we're working hard, the chairman always trying to see what we can do. It's not easy. That's why we need everybody on board. And I stress very heavily here that the parents need to be on board as well, not just about old boys and friends of Kingston College, but parents being on board and supportive, because at the end of the day, it's their kid, it's their child, and the education that they're getting is theirs as well. So, you know, the support needs to be there. And so I'm saying it's a lot to do, it's a lot to take in, but bottom line is this, it has to be done. And I'm a believer in never being weary in well doing. And so just to see kids come out, some of the kids who have gone off to college, who we thought, you know, that you'd never have thought they'd have made it, that is reward enough for us. And so that spurs me on and say, we're going to have to get it done. And so I'm seeking and asking and pleading with you all to join with us to do things. Even those persons who are always being critics of everything that is done, I'm saying, yes, be critics, but come and join us as well, all right, and help, because helping one kid, ensuring that one kid makes it through, is actually a massive thing, all right? And so we're going to ask for your help in that. So in closing here, and I think I may have used up most of my time, but in closing, I want to thank a number of persons here. I want to thank Perry and his team for putting these, you know, COVID-19 town hall meetings on. And I know it's a lot that Perry takes on and does. But this is a guy who just works tirelessly all the time to ensure that he gets things done as well. And so Perry and the team, I want to thank you and congratulate you. And I just mention here as well, for all the scholarships that you continue to support at the school, millions of dollars in scholarship. Again, we just want to thank you big time for that. I want to thank the Florida chapter, because they're always there as well. Audley Hewitt, Wayne Fraser, Ivan Nugent, Everton, all of these guys who just work tirelessly to support what we're doing. We just want to thank you for the help and the support. Want to thank the Tampa chapter as well, because they're there supporting, doing what needs to be done. And we just applaud you for the help and support. To the Toronto chapter as well, you know, we just want to thank you as well for the continued support, President Clive, for the support. We just want to thank you for that as we continue to do the work we need to do at the school. Atlanta, again, Alvin and his team, we just want to highlight you and say thanks for the support. You know, without the support, we wouldn't be where we are. And in fact, just to add to Atlanta here, is that even with a number of the scholarships that we're doing, I'd reach out to Alvin, and Alvin jumped on it as well and helped us. And that's what helped to push the number of scholarships that we're able to achieve up to the 23 or 22 that we did. So again, thanks for all the support. I want to highlight as well the KCOBA, newly formed chapter in Europe. And I think, you know, Sam should be on. I want to thank you guys. I was really pleased to have been part of that Zoom meeting that you had in terms of kicking off. And you've already shown your mettle in terms of what you've done for us already. And so just want to thank you. And I know as a chapter, you're going to go places as well. I want to also, you know, give deep felt thanks to the class of 1973 for their support. I also want to highlight the class of 1980 also for their financial support, and the class of 1981. These classes, 1973, 1980, 1981, these old boys have, you know, stepped out and contributed and made sure. In fact, you know, between the 1980 and 1981 group, they're seeking to outdo each other. And I love that, because it means more for the college. And so thank you guys for the support. I want to highlight here two persons that, you know, may not have been spoken about much. won again, Wayne Hewitt. And Wayne Hewitt, you know, came to KC up to third form and moved on and then migrated. And Wayne, ever since being at Kingston College, every year he's been supporting Kingston College with significant donations. That has helped. And in fact, when I spoke to him, he called me and asked me how things were going COVID, and I told him what we were doing and about the web cameras. And he immediately sent a check and said, here you are, use this to help to purchase these. Again, additional support that he does. There's a gentleman called Al Carey who virtually as his only contact to KC is again via Wayne Hewitt and Audley, but he sees himself as a KC old boy, and he's given significant contribution to the school over the past 3 years. In fact, he said to me, and Al Carey, he just retired, I think, as the CEO of PepsiCo USA. And, you know, he said to me, you know, donning his purple at Champs 1 year, said, Dave, I'm now a KC old boy, and I'll make sure I contribute to KC. And he's also been giving his contribution. And so I want to thank him as well. Errol McLaughlin out in Bahamas, you know, here's an old boy who's always sending, you know, to say help, use this to help with welfare. I just want to highlight you all for your contribution to Kingston College. And so again, I thank those chapters named as well as classes named, the number of classes that have been part of what we're doing, and the individuals. I can't finish without thanking and giving our appreciation to our hardworking PTA president and our parent reps, as well as the nurses that worked through the whole COVID period with us, and through the revision classes and online. You know, we just want to thank our PTA. They're always there. President Peter Gay, who is really supportive, very supportive of what we're doing. And the parent reps were very supportive as well. We want to thank you, because your help is invaluable. And I want to finish with heartfelt thanks to the staff. My staff, who have gone beyond the call of duty to ensure that the school continues to function, the guidance counselors who have jumped in, done the work, do what needs to be done, Ms. Esco, Mr. Shaw. When I say Mr. Shaw, weighing out flour, packing out rice, all of these things to make sure care packages are done, you know, and all the staff who go beyond the call of duty to ensure that both the online program function and the revision program function. I want to thank those members of staff as well. To the senior management team, your support is invaluable as we weighed this. I want to highlight Dr. June Hernandez for unfailing support. She was instrumental in helping the scholarship boys as well, and she's always there supporting Kingston College in terms of what we do. To the chairman and board of management, I want to thank you also for your invaluable support. And finally, to the many KCO boys and friends of KC who continue to support the development of our young men, we thank you and we look forward to your continued support. You know, the road ahead will present many challenges, but I believe that if we work together and continue to work together as a true family, we will overcome those challenges. So thank you all again. God bless Kingston College and Fortis forever. Thank you.
Great. Thank you for that detailed presentation on the running of Brand Fortis. We hear the challenges. We definitely hear the challenges, Mr. Principal, and I'm encouraged by that line about never being weary of doing good. Tough, but we press on. We're committed. We are grateful for your leadership, sir. Thank you. So allow me to make a quick announcement. We're having Damion teed up, ready to go again. Give us a quick minute before work's pulling. But I must share with you at this point, my Fortis family and friends, that on April, when we launched the Fortis Primetime event, we invited you to join the Fortis COVID-19 relief effort as our moral imperative to ensure that Kingston College is positioned to survive this pandemic and to go on to thrive in the new normal. You responded, and tonight I'm happy to announce that together we have raised $95,800 so far. So thank you very much. You heard Principal Myrie's presentation. There is so much more work to be done. KC still needs more support. With your generosity, we can meet our goal of $120,000. For this Fortis COVID-19 relief effort, by the new start date of school, so we've just gotten some more time to dig in and to go again as we give with our heart and love and passion for Kingston College. So with that said, I'm gonna try to make sure we get Damion Crawford, who is out there waiting to join us. And Damion Crawford is our esteemed old boy down there in Jamaica, who as a University of the West Indies lecturer and community activist, just to name a few of his titles. We welcome you to join us this evening, Mr. Damion Crawford.
Hi, brothers. How are you doing?
Good, man. We're hearing you loud and clear.
Yes, great, great. I'm saying that I am very, very happy to see the leadership from the chairman and the principal. You know that in these times we have competent leadership going forward. Unfortunately, not all schools will be able to say the same, but I am pleased to know that our institution is continuing in a wonderful path with the leadership. There comes a time in the life of men that are lucky, where their country call upon them to fight on its behalf. Not many men have had that opportunity, but we in this generation now have that opportunity to fight on behalf of our nation through our institution, Kingston College. What the country is about to face, I don't think many of us understand, based on the fallout that has happened in the economy, based on what is happening in the health, and based on how susceptible our people were on the brink going forward. And so our boys will be facing a very difficult time in their own lives, with many disappointments as it relates to just the normal school life, the normal school activities, and the changes that would have to be made in how education is delivered, how transportation will be organized, and even how their extracurricular activities will be taking place. I can imagine the disappointment after training for the entire year that some of our boys felt when Boys Champs was cancelled. And we're not so sure if we'll be seeing the Manning Cup or any of the other activities that they must have been looking forward to all their Kingston College lives. Many who went through Pepsi and Colts couldn't wait for their opportunity to go into Manning Cup. And so they will need us as the past students, as the old boys, as the stalwarts at the Kingston College, who had 7 and 5 and 3 years experience of what it means to never fail, what it means to never give up, what it means to never die. And by extension, I am committing myself both in time and money to ensure that they mitigate the negatives and enhance the positives of this particular situation. I'm also calling upon all the brothers out there, fight for your nation through your institute, Kingston, because we're going to be needing more guidance counselors. I hear the principal speaking to some of the people that we need, but the instability in some of our homes based on people losing their jobs, based on inability to afford, based on changes happening within our society, many of our boys will be impacted in a way that guidance will be more necessary. And I believe that the Big Brother program is even more important now than it ever was before. In persons to intervene by telephone, by Zoom, and by other methods to assist persons who don't have competent parents to assist with the homework, to assist with the guidance, with any percentage of homeschooling. And I'm calling on the brothers to understand that while we need money, time is also money for those who may not be able to contribute as much as they would like. We're going to need more welfare. The principal highlighted that, because 56% of manufacturing companies suggest that they have been laying off persons. There's also the hotels that we don't see the light of day, but some would have depended on remittances to sustain the family. Some of our boys' mothers are overseas, fathers overseas. They are also facing difficult times. And so we're going to be needing a breakfast program. We might even have to extend it to a lunch program. And those would have to be extended and expanded, because some who were once independent now will be shifting over to the unfortunate side of dependence. So at this point, we need to raise $120,000 at the first hurdle. This is like when we're at Champs and we see that great record breaker went over hurdle 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Raise at the first hurdle $120,000, and I'm asking the brothers to become disciples. 222 of us are now on this platform. become disciples. The Lord said to go out there and become fisher of men. I was in class there with a laugh. I said, why you want to be a fisher of men? But we need to go out there, find the other brothers that have not been exposed. We are going through our own difficulties at this particular point in time, but there is no war without difficulty. There is no fight without some level of discomfort. And so we are asking the brothers to commit time, to commit money, and to commit effort to helping our young sons, our young brothers, to go through this period that some of them might not even understand why it is happening to them. Kingston College made me twice the man that I would have been had I not gone to Kingston College. I've called upon the motto many a times in my personal life, and I've been given great satisfaction and been given great medication as it relates to just depression from Kingston College performance. I remember winning the Manning Cup. I have never felt so happy, or I can't remember a time been so happy by just an achievement by others when I wasn't on the field. I remember the first time we won back champs, and I mean, I was so elated. I think it's our time to give back to our institution that has given so much to us. Those who have been given to give more to an institution that has built us. And so I'm committing myself, and I'm asking the 222 men here to ensure that Kingston College remains one of the ultimate institutions within the Western Hemisphere, and that the experience that we got, the love that we have engendered, shown for the young boys, the young brothers, the young sons that are going through this difficult time. I'm very happy to be a part of this. As you know, we're engaged in a little activity, and I'm going to be a coach in the debates. But I'm asking you, gentlemen, please continue to give, continue to support, and let us tell the principal and the other organizers, the chairman and others, what competence we have in what subject areas, that we can become tutors for our little brothers and also become mentors, which is going to be much more important going forward. I thank you for the opportunity, and I look forward to the next communication with the team.
Mr. Damion Crawford, thank you so very much, sir, for taking time out. I am mindful that you're getting ready to go conduct your duties. We really appreciate that powerful Fortis cry to stir the passion and just remind everyone that it's time, talent, and your treasures. And thank you again for that powerful presentation, Mr. Crawford. And without further ado, I am really excited now to pivot to our special guest speaker. He's one of the many examples of why the Fortis brand is ranked in the top five brands of Jamaica. He was nicknamed the Whispering Death. He's a Fortis Jamaican and West Indies cricket legend, and currently a cricket commentator coming off duty from Test cricket in England, Mr. Michael Holding. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Perry. And hello to everyone, Reverend McIntyre, Father Michael, Principal Myrie, Chairman Vaccianna, you know, all the other presenters and everyone that's attending this meeting here at the moment. It's not a lot that I can add to what has already been said, to be honest, because there has been so much said by everyone. I think Mr. Myrie really spelled out exactly what the situation is with Casey, and it's just up to us now to try and make sure that the funding is in place for all these activities. Some of us may look and say it's difficult for us to find any money to contribute. You know, as Damion said, money is not the only thing that can be contributed. Time can be contributed. As Mr. Myrie said, so many people helped out, whether they were nurses or just people going down to the school to help in whatever activity the school needed to be done. But even though some of us might think it is difficult to find the money, if we even think of it as a little sacrifice along the way to try and help the kids at KC, I think we can do it. Simple things that can add up, you know, buying two less beers every evening when you go for a drink, buying one pack less cigarette if you're a smoker, buying two cups of coffee less, you know, that sort of thing. all those little things build up. We have over 200 people that are attending this right now. Everyone that's attending could do something like that and save a little bit of money that they can contribute to the school. That would help a great deal. It doesn't have to be $1 million all at once. A little from everyone contributing will certainly help a great deal. And that's all we need to be looking towards. I can't do anything else but to appeal to everyone. You all went through KC. You all know what KC did for all of us. You have a lot of youngsters now trying to get through the same thing that we went through. Education, learning about life, learning particular subjects at school, and they need help. They need a lot of help. And whatever help we can give them, I think it's important that we can find some way of contributing. It doesn't have to be a lot of money all at the same time. A little at a time. We can even put aside a small amount per month. Once it's something that you know you can afford every month, put it aside and say, okay, this is going to go towards KC. You can send it every month. You can save it and send it at the end of the year. But once you can know you can afford a certain amount every month and just put it aside and say, this is going towards KC. It might be a little bit of a sacrifice, but remember, other people sacrificed for us when we were at KC. We might not know about the sacrifice, but I'm absolutely sure other people would have sacrificed to help us when we were going through KC. So we have to try and do that ourselves. Headmaster Myrie just mentioned that about 22 or 23 kids have already gotten scholarships to go to the US. What I would like to see happening at the school is a few funds going towards the library in particular and putting certain books and certain forms of information into that library so that these kids can be well aware of what their forefathers did. We don't want to go to the United States and people, we know what the United States is like right now. We know the situation up there. And we want to be able to send kids up there that are very proud of their forefathers, very proud of their background, so that when they go up to the United States, they can hold their heads up high. Not just because they're a KC. When you're a KC man, you hold your head up high anyway. But because of you knowing your knowledge of what your people have done many, many, many years ago, you can hold your head even higher. Because that's very important in this world. So that we can educate everyone to the right degree, the right education to the right level of education. And that's so, so important. So everyone listening in, as I said, there's not a lot I can add to the previous speakers, but all I can do is to implore you all, contribute. Contribute as much as you possibly can. And sometimes even when you think you can't, do it anyway, because the good Lord will find a way of reimbursing you and making sure that you are okay when you think that you have stretched yourself. You'll find a way. The good Lord will help you to find a way to make sure that you are okay. So everyone, thanks for having me on this video program. I just hope everyone can understand the needs of the school, because this school contributed so much to all of us. And we can help to contribute to the school and to the kids going through the school right now. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so very much, Mr. Michael Holden, and thank you for taking time out to join us. We're very mindful that it's 1:30 p.m. GMT where you are calling in from right now. So again, 1:30 a.m. that is. So again, thank you very much for that powerful word. And to keep things moving along, because we definitely want to ensure that we make time for the Q&A, I am going to tee up, and it with much pride that I'm going to introduce our final presenter to emerge from behind the control. Our moderator, KCOBA Board Director, Assistant Treasurer, and Certified Professional Accountant, Mr. Royland Garden.
Good night, everyone. Good night, everyone. I certainly hope that you're enjoying the presentations. I must remind you that KCOBA really appreciates your support. And simply put, we could not do what we do for Kingston College without your commitment and dedication to the Fortis mission. You have heard from the chairman, Mr. Vaccianna, the principal, Mr. Myrie, and the message and appeal from Mr. Holden and Mr. Crawford. The upcoming school year will be a challenging one. I can assure you that Mr. Myrie and his team will not be able to solve those problems without our support. It is only together, by each of us doing our part and contributing to the Fortis COVID relief effort and encouraging a fellow Fortis to do the same, is the only way that we can ensure that the school has the resources that it needs to survive and thrive in the new normal. We are inviting you to join us and make your mark. Before COVID-19, the school enjoyed a tremendous success in academia and sports. This could be derailed by the impact of COVID-19. To avoid this, we must act now. Thus far, we have raised just over $96,000. The immediate ask is to get it to $120,000 before the new school year starts. This might sound a lot, but $120,000 is just 14% of the school operating budget. On your screen now is the contact and banking information for all our member associations. This information is also posted in the chat and will be available publicly. Please act now. Please make a contribution. Many of our associations accept electronic payment, such as PayPal and Zelle. They all accept checks. You can send your check to the association of your choice at the address listed here. If you're in Jamaica, the local association bank accounts are with NCB. Please make a transfer or visit an NCB branch and make a deposit. Every dollar donated will ensure that KC stays on the positive trajectory. The Fortis COVID relief effort would only account for 14% of the school operating budget. We need your ongoing contribution to ensure that we continuously fund the activities at the school. How do you contribute? Join any one of our associations and pay your annual membership dues. Attend and promote our fundraisers. Purchase merchandise from our online stores. Donate to an academic program or an athletic program, or fund a branded scholarship. Support KCOBA, support Kingston College. A majority of the funds raised from these events and activities go directly to program initiatives at Kingston College. We would also like to highlight a few ways in which you can maximize your contribution to Kingston College. Shop on Amazon. Use smile.amazon.com. KCOBA will receive 0.5% of your purchase. You could also consider asking or inquiring if your company has a COVID relief program. Maybe their company will donate computers or tablets to support the e-learning environment, or they'll make a generous donation. How about the company matching your contribution that you would have made to Kingston College, multiplying your donation? Also think about planned giving. Fortis Network has been a pillar of support for Kingston College. We want to acknowledge all the class affiliation for their continuous contribution to the Fortis mission. Fortis WhatsApp group for connecting Fortis worldwide. The KC Times for promoting Fortis forever. We're encouraging you to spread the word on the COVID relief effort and through your various platforms. We're also asking you that you use your platform to promote KCOBA and its activities. We also want to invite you to partner with KCOBA on its initiatives. As Mr. Myrie said, and as all the presenters before me, we simply cannot wait until our CSEC results start to fall, or there are reports in the media about our condition of the learning environment at KC to act. Let's act now. Thank you for listening. Fortis forever, forever Fortis. I turn it over to you, Perry.
Thank you, Mr. Royland Garden, for making the debut here on these events that you have been tirelessly working behind the scenes to execute. So with that said, it's time to hear some of your questions. And with that, we'll bring Mr. Alton Brown. But just before I bring up Mr. Alton Brown, I just want to shout out the graduating class of 1980, 81, and 73 for your donations. And I want to use that to encourage other graduating class to combine, because there's strength in numbers, as demonstrated by those classes before you. So without further ado, Mr. Alton Brown, Vice President of KCOBA, to lead us in the Q&A segment. Mr. Brown? Audio, Mr. Brown, we're not hearing you well. Actually, not hearing you at all. Check that audio. Seeing you clearly, not hearing you. Still not hearing you. Oh, wait a minute. You're muted. I just unmuted. Say something. Still not hearing you, sir. Okay, one more technical pitch here. We're coming to you with your questions. Bear with us. So George, you're gonna take over? Okay, our brother George, Secretary of the Association, is gonna take over. He was behind the scenes with Alton. Go ahead, sir. George?
I'm here.
Okay, go ahead.
Good night, everyone. Thanks for tuning in. We have a couple questions. Hopefully, principal is still with us. One question has to do with, I guess, it's sports in general. Will training for track and field, football, be suspended when school reopens?
Okay, as far as, first thing is that limited training had started for football. And just this week, ISSA, the governing body for sports, indicated that all sporting activities for this term will be cancelled. So there will be no sporting activity for this term as far as ISSA's competitions are concerned. What they've said is over the next couple of weeks, they're going to be looking at the situation to determine for the other two terms going forward what will happen. So we know that football's off right now, and all of the competitions that would have taken place in the Christmas term, they're off. We're not sure what's going to happen as far as champs and those activities are concerned. Limited training had started for track and field as well. I think that's going to build down, but we await both ISSA and the Ministry of Health as far as that's concerned. But, you know, the possibility exists that maybe nearly all sporting activities could be cancelled for the year. But that's the decision that ISSA will make based on Ministry of Health guidelines.
Thank you, Mr. Principal. And bear with me if I'm running through. We have time against us. Someone asks, with the new normal, would the school create individual email addresses for all students?
Yes, we're already in the process of doing that. You know, we're using, we've been involved in the use of Microsoft Teams or Microsoft 365. Email addresses are being created for every single student. We have a member of staff who's tasked with managing a lot of the online scenario for students, and she's heavily in the process of doing all of that right now. So, yes.
Thank you, sir. You're at it again. This has to do with the expansion of school building with will renewable energy be integrated to reduce costs?
The short answer is yes.
Okay, that's good. Short answers are good. And yeah, we have another one speaks to solar panels. So I guess that answer cover the solar panel.
We've been looking at the top of the Douglas Forest building that we're putting up now. We're looking at the whole of the top of that, the possibility for solar. In fact, we've even had assessments done already for that. Yeah, we had two assessments done, and we're looking at what we're going to be doing. But yes, we're looking at alternative energy.
I'm somewhere in me, I think you covered this question in your presentation. But let's ask, what plans are in place to bridge the gap between instruction and student engagement slash support?
Kind of unpick that a bit for me, because if could you repeat that, what plans are in place?
What plans are in place to bridge the gap between instruction and student engagement or student support?
I'd love to ask the person who asked that question to kind of unpick that a bit more for me, if I understand. It's the student support and student engagement. Are we talking about engaging students in teaching face to face, or what do we mean? I'm not sure I understand.
I would guess it just has to do with COVID, the new normal, and as I said, in my mind, I think you'd have covered it in your presentation.
I think if I just answer this way, all right. Clearly, the new normal is that face to face is going to be limited. So a lot of the engagement with students is going to take place via online, if you like. And we're geared up for that. A lot of the technology issues I spoke to is just precisely to address that. In terms of how we manage that, and we're setting ourselves up in a situation that if, for example, the government says schools won't reopen for the next term, that we can go right off to online teaching and function efficiently as we did between March and June. All right, so we're looking at that, and we're setting ourselves up properly to be able to function whichever way, whether it be a blended face-to-face, some face-to-face and total online, or if it's total online engagement, then we're ready for that as well.
Okay, one question here. I guess normally we ask this question. What is the biggest struggle you're currently facing? That is, if you can only solve one thing, what would be your one thing at this moment?
Yeah, boy, that's a tough one, because how do you prioritize the priorities? Is the realistic? There are a number of issues to be addressed. I suppose the one big, if I want to come down on one thing, is get the network upgrade. It's fully done. We'll ensure that we function the way we need to. Not just for now, for the now and the COVID, but also going forward in the way online is happening and the way exams are going to be happening online, CXCs and CAPE. We want to be geared up and structured for that. So I suppose for me, the big one is getting our online fully sorted and functional.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I have one more here. I'm trying to make it out. Is the board actively encouraging the establishment of foundations to benefit the school?
Yes, I don't know if Chairman can answer that if he's still on, but I would say yes, because remember there's a Kingston College Trust Fund, and that takes the place of that in creating foundations and endowment. And you know, they're also asking so that, you know, they can actually help assist. And most years, the way the trust fund is so structured is that there's some level of funding that will come towards a capital project each year that the school would have to apply to the trust fund for it. So, you know, through the trust fund, I suppose that is addressed. But the chairman, I see the chairman's on there, so chairman can speak to that one more effectively, chair.
Yeah, it's really to reiterate, Dave, the trust exists as the foundation for the school at this moment. And we would not want to create any additional foundations to water down the work and the impact of the the trust has had on the assistance in school. So if the question is relating to a contribution being made through a foundation, the trust is there that the contribution can be done through them. And I just had one thing that regularly, as the principal just outlined, they make contributions for capital projects. And they have, in fact, this year made an exception because of the COVID crisis to allow expenditure for even non-capital matters. So they are working with us, and we have worked well over the years. And we just need to build that foundation, that trust, some more, because the funds that are there now, as a part of the endowment, really ought to be increased, and efforts are being made, I know, by Chairman and his board to increase the funding and the endowment funds, but more needs to be done. And again, persons online here and other persons can assist by making contributions to the trust in that regard.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Whilst you're at it, time is up against us. I'll ask, maybe this individual asks, how can we contact the school board chairman, Mr. Vaccianna? So yourself and then Principal Myrie, if you can, if you're willing to announce here how you can easily be contacted. To piggyback on that, individual wanted to know if the school had RTGS. I imagine that some electronic payment, the school could receive electronic payment. But basically, I need both of you two gentlemen to announce how an individual can get to you. Is it an email or something like that? And then that will end the question and answer section.
Email is good for me. Dave, you want to go ahead?
Yes, the email is good for me as well. And mine is a very simple one, which is dave.myrie@yahoo.com. And you know, you can get me there, and you know, once I receive that, you know, depending on what will you, obviously I'll respond to you on that. So it's Dave, all lowercase, dave.myrie@yahoo.com.
Thank you, Mr. President. Great job, Mr. Chairman.
Mine is M.M. Vaccianna. And Vaccianna, the full spelling is on the screen, I believe. That's mmvaccianna@cwjamaica.com.
Thank you, gentlemen. I'm going to turn over back to Mr. President. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, everyone who is still with us on the call.
And thank you, George and Alton. And we have Father Brown. Father Brown will be giving us out our closing prayer. So stick around with us. We want to also get in a piece from that Kingston College Chapel Choir.
Thank you.
Father Brown.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in times of uncertainty, you are the only surety. Continue to journey with us, we pray, amidst the challenges that our present pandemic has bestowed upon us. We continue to pray for our decision makers and ask that you give them the wisdom to direct our affairs as we make our pilgrimage in these difficult times. For our health workers, we pray that you will protect them from the dangers associated with this pandemic as they take the lead in the fight to keep us healthy. Yet with all that is happening and is yet to happen, there is the need to get on with our lives while seeking to keep safe. Help us to be responsible persons, to make our actions and activities be in keeping with all necessary protocols. Help us never to follow the wrongful actions of those who show no respect for what is right and show scant regard for the safety of others and their own safety. May those who are placed in positions of leadership and those whom the society and the world hold in high esteem be responsible in their actions and help the society and the world to do that which is right. Pray especially for those persons our children see as role models. We pray that they will set good examples for our youth to follow. As we face the challenges associated with the reopening of our schools and all other educational institutions, we look to you for the wisdom from on high. Grant wisdom and guidance to our principals and all others who administer the affairs of our schools, that right decisions and actions will be taken. For parents and guardians who are afraid at this time of uncertainty, grant your peace. For students who face these uncertainties and confusion, grant your grace and calm. Help them to participate responsibly in their own educational development so that in safety they may achieve your will for their life. And we pray for our beloved Kingston College, for Michael, the chairman of the Board of Governors, Dave, our principal, Everton, Juliet, and Margarita, our vice principals, all others in administration, our dedicated teachers, our students, parents, guardians, supporting staff members, and well-wishers. Help us to put our various gifts and talents together and, guided by your heavenly wisdom, do all that we can to assist in the reopening of our school and the development of our children. We pray for those who continue to contribute to the development of our children at KC, and especially as we make all the necessary preparations for welfare, for repairs, and put in place well-needed infrastructure, equipment, and material. May your providence, through benefactors, partners, sponsors, old boys, parents, guardians, and well-wishers, always abound, that the vision of our founders and the ministry of your church may continue to be realized to the glory of your name and through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Very much, Michael Brown. And ladies and gentlemen, I just want to say a big thank you to our presenters tonight. Thank you to the KCO Boys International. That's all our KCO Boys organization. Thank you to the COVID-19 relief team. That's Alton, Barrington, Dwayne, Everton, George, Royland, and Winston. The design team, Andrew Jones, and you, the Fortis family and friends. Thank you for joining our Fortis Primetime. Let's maintain connection and an open channel into Kingston College. God bless you and good night.